On this episode of Eat Meat Repeat, I want to show you how to cook a couple different parts of the chicken and the science of dry brine salting. These easy to follow tips and tricks will transform your poultry game to a whole new level. Check it out. First up, we have the common skinless, boneless chicken breast. We're going to experiment with these a bit by cooking them through three different skillets. Next up, everyone's party favorite, the world famous chicken wings. I will share with you a secret on how to make these even crispier than their soybean oil fried counterparts. When I discovered this hefty bone-in split chicken breast, my life was changed forever. Requiring the least amount of prep, this will become a household favorite. Lastly, I have the pleasure to introduce the whole bird with the honor to announce the spatchcock method of roasting. Spatchcock. Look it up. It's a real thing. You are going to use this to win over family and friends with this epic cooking technique. Take a look at the three different tools for our chicken breast. The cast iron, the stainless steel skillet, and the nonstick frying pan. I've done all the experimenting to show you how each one will produce slightly different textures and taste. Now let me teach you a little bit about the science of salt, because we're going to be using a lot of it. Sodium chloride, aka table salt, is an ionic compound with strong attractive forces for the highly polar water molecules. So what this basically means is that leaving salt spread on the surface of your chicken pulls moisture from the interior, giving you the ability to crisp your meat more efficiently. Just look at how much water accumulated on the surface in just 20 minutes. Do this to all your chicken breast and be sure to pat dry with paper towels. Finally, let's get cooking. Put your cast iron on medium-high heat, then drop your chicken on once it's smoking hot. The cast iron is best choice for thick cuts. The cooking press isn't absolutely necessary, but if you have one, keep it on the thicker side. Cook for 6 minutes before flipping it to the opposite side, where it will grill for an additional 5 to 6 minutes. Now here's a pro chicken tip. Do not cook your chicken to an internal temp of 165 degrees, because this will leave you with a dreadfully dry piece of meat. The best chefs will tell you the secret to moist chicken is an internal temp of 150 degrees. Amazingly moist and juicy, the cast iron creates this bold crust speckled with bits of darkened charred edges resembling that of which you could get on a propane grill. Definitely one of my favorites. For our next two cuts, let's slice them thin, creating a chicken cutlet. Preheat your stainless steel to a medium heat. Stainless steel contains this beautiful property of getting the chicken to glue to the surface. This bond between hot steel and meat produces a wonderful composition in the end. Bringing bacon grease into the picture will provide a bit more flavor and produce a better crisp. A piece of chicken this thin will take about 3 minutes on one side before needing a flip. Cook for another 3 minutes and you're done. In contrast to the cast iron, the skillet creates a thinner, more delicate crunch, topped with that subtle layer of bacon grease. With our last chicken cutlet, preheat your nonstick frying pan to just above medium heat. Immediately add some bacon grease or beef tallow, and once that fat begins to sizzle, throw down your meat. After 4 minutes, turn over and cook for another 4 minutes, and you're done. Now enter the almighty split chicken breast, coming in at god tier amongst its lower class of chicken parts. Mostly unknown to the amateur cooking world, this thing is cheap, effortless to cook, and brimming with juicy fat. It's a skin-on, bone-in masterpiece and makes an ideal candidate when paired with the air fryer. And here's how simple it is. Generously salt the skin on just the top and turn your air fryer onto 400 degrees. Set a timer for 40 minutes, then walk away because you're done. For smaller pieces, use a cooking time of 30 minutes. And don't forget, do not let your chicken exceed 150 degrees. Now typically, I'd rip the skin off and eat that first. Then I'd rip huge bites straight off the bone, no fork or knife required. But since you guys are watching, I'm going to act a bit more formal and show you where to separate meat from bone. A lot of you probably notice that pinkish color towards the center, but don't be fooled because it's not undercooked. Split chicken always has that pinkish tint adjacent to the tenderloin and bones. If you don't have an air fryer, take your chicken out of the fridge and don't be afraid to leave it on the counter for a half hour or so. Let it get up to room temperature, then bake it in the oven on a wire rack at 500 degrees between 30 and 45 minutes. If your oven is fancy enough to have a convection button, use that instead of bake. Mmm, that skin tastes so good. Want to make your chicken even juicier? Take all that fat caught in the air fryer and drizzle it onto your chicken. Or don't, and put it in a jar like you would for bacon grease and save it for frying later. Now, if you have the opportunity, buy air-chilled chicken, and here's why. The government mandates that all poultry must be cooled to 40 degrees or lower within hours of slaughter to prevent the growth of bad bacteria. Air chilling works by blasting the chickens with purified cold air, cooling them without the use of ice baths. Ice baths are an inferior method of cooling because as the chicken sits in chlorinated water, it will absorb excess moisture into the skin. After you salt your wings, keep them sitting in the fridge for an hour or two. When you're ready, preheat the air fryer to 375 degrees and do not overstuff. If you crowd the cooking chamber, your wings will not crisp. They need to be spread out to receive enough air circulation, so it's best to work in small batches. Cooking times will vary anywhere between 10 to 15 minutes, all depending on how well done you like your wings. Whatever you decide, toss those wings around halfway through their cooking cycle. These are done once you have achieved a golden brown skin color. There's no need to check for an internal temp because as long as the outside looks crisped, it's guaranteed cooked all the way through. Now I promise, if you follow these instructions step by step, applying all the little tips and tricks, you'll end up with a perfectly crispy chicken wing every time. Considering there's only about 50 calories in one wing, those on the carnivore diet may resort to chicken wings as a late night snack. Otherwise, one would have to consume approximately 40 wings to match a standard 25 ounce ribeye dinner. Alright, let me teach you how to spatchcock a whole bird and the three major advantages you get over traditional methods of roasting. First up, if you haven't already, remove the chicken innards and save these in the freezer for a stock. Organ meats like the kidneys, liver, and heart make for a nutrient-dense carnivore soup as these will tenderize nicely on a low simmer. Take your kitchen scissors and cut along both sides of the backbone in order to remove it entirely. I would also save this piece for all its flavor and fat for a soup. Now flip over your bird because we're going to need a little pressure here. You want to push down on this breastbone until it gives a little crack, just so it lies flat. So why does going through all these extra steps have its advantages? Well, a flatter shape means more even cooking, all the skin is on top so everything gets crisp, and a more horizontal bird also means faster cooking. After you're done generously salting your chicken, transfer it to a wire rack and baking sheet. Then stick it in the fridge for at least several hours. If you're looking to maximize the crispiness, leave it in overnight for the dry brine to take effect. Here's how it looks after 24 hours of sitting uncovered in the fridge. The skin has become very dry and any surface moisture has evaporated. Preheat your oven to 500 degrees and grab your baking sheet so we can line it with aluminum foil. Be sure to use plenty of foil because at 500 degrees, your bird is going to release a bunch of moisture and fat. Transfer your chicken to the baking sheet and you're officially ready to put it in the oven for roasting. To give you an idea for cooking times, this chicken weighed in at just over 3 pounds and took 45 minutes to reach an internal temp of 150 degrees. Anything weighing in over 4 pounds would have to cook for an additional 10 to 15 minutes. Out of this chicken, we will get 2 wings, 2 thighs, and 2 breasts. If you've never parsed out a whole chicken before, here's my advice. Start by grabbing one end of the thigh bone and give it a solid tug to see where it would break away from the main part of the body. Observe where it begins to stretch and crack because this is where you'll cut with your knife. The wings will come off in the same way. When you're left with just the body, use your strength to cut it in half right down the middle. Now you can see where the split chicken breast comes from. And that's pretty much it. Go straight for the skin as this is easily the best part. If you have any questions, post a comment below so I can get a feel for what kind of carnivore recipes you want to see. If you guys want to see more videos, please like and subscribe. As always, eat, meat, repeat. Peace out.